Greetings in Jesus' name this morning, and happy Easter. We're going to lead you in a few songs this morning, and we'll start with that. Come set your rule. We build your kingdom here. So, here we go. Shining. Amen. Amen. Last song we'd like to lead you in is Because He Lives. It's the chorus, the praise chorus, which is a little different. I believe in the Son, I believe in the risen one. Give us a minute to switch around. And if Pastor Craig wants to edit this out, that's fine too. We'll do two verses of In the Garden. Thank you. We'll leave you with that. Have a good Easter.
I am blessed to share with you one of my favorite praise songs, and so appropriate for today, called Living Hope.
Chasm that lay between us, how high the Good morning, and welcome on this beautiful Easter Sunday morning. My name is Craig Loewen. I'm the pastor of the Heidlersburg Mount Olivet Charge at the Church of the United Brethren in Christ. It is so good to have you join us this morning. For Christ has risen. He has risen indeed. Today, we, with all of Christendom, celebrate the physical resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. There is so much that I could share with you today. There is so much to the story that is recorded in all four of the Gospels, but I've chosen just a small section from the Gospel of John, chapter 20. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. So she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter and the other disciple went forth, and they were going to the tomb. The two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first. And stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. And so Simon Peter also came, following him, and entered the tomb, and he saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the face cloth which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So the other disciple who had first came to the tomb then also entered, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So the disciples went away again to their own homes. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping, and so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had been lying. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father and my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came announcing to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. The drama of Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday, is filled with all sorts of stories that we can find in the four Gospels. And they all tell of the exciting reality that Jesus Christ physically rose from the dead after his crucifixion and on Friday and being laid in the tomb later that evening. A lot of people ask me, was it really necessary? Was it really important that Jesus Christ died on the cross, that he was buried, and that he rose again from the dead? The Bible relates the story in the first three chapters of Genesis of the creation of the world and tells the story of Adam and Eve, and describes in detail the fall of humanity. This was a situation that has affected all of Adam's descendants since then. In order for it to be made right, there was no human being that could rectify the situation. It had to be God himself. So God, in the second person of the Godhead, God the Son, came, and he had to die on that cross. I know that that may be politically incorrect, and many people have said to me, "I don't require anyone to die for me so that I may be saved." But in the economy of God's spiritual world, it was necessary. If it had not been necessary, God would not have sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross for our sins and our iniquities, and to purchase for us our salvation, to become the ultimate Paschal Lamb, the propitiation for our sins. And the thing is that Jesus Christ also had to physically rise from the dead. And the reason for that is because when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, when we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, we become a new creation. 33 things happen to us at that moment. One of them being that we are adopted into the family of God and we are made his children, his sons, and his daughters. We become heirs and co-heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And the thing is, we get to share in everything that Jesus did. In his death, he died to the law and to sin and was raised again. And we share in that death as well as we share in the righteousness that Jesus Christ has, as well as we share in his physical resurrection. And someday we who believe in Christ will also be physically resurrected. The church at Corinth had a lot of problems. And we read about those problems in Paul's first and second letter to the church at Corinth, called 1 and 2 Corinthians. One of the problems that the church had was confusion that the resurrection of the dead would never happen. That it was either something that was a symbol or something that was more or less a fairy tale and can be safely ignored, or it could be passed off as something that had no reality and no bearing in the Christian's life. Paul wrote to them about the reality, about what that means if there is no resurrection of the dead, and what that means if Jesus Christ did not physically resurrect from the dead. The words are very stirring. He writes in 1 Corinthians 15, "But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, Adam, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man, Jesus Christ. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive." So it is important. Everything hinges in Christianity on the physical resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That unlike what some philosophies believe, that he rose again as a spirit or as a ghost or as a symbol. If that is true, then there is no resurrection of the dead for any of us. But if Jesus Christ physically rose from the dead, as the four Gospels testify, then it means something very important to us, because someday we too shall share in that physical resurrection. For we are saved from the penalty of sin when we place our faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And as we live our life in Christ through the work of the Holy Spirit, we are saved gradually from the power of sin. But it is that day when we receive our new bodies that are completely untouched by sin, we will be saved from the very power of sin itself. And that is why we celebrate Easter. Because not only do we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, we also look forward to the day when we, as followers of Christ, will someday also be raised from the dead into beautiful new bodies that will not know age or the laws of entropy. Thank you so much for joining me this Easter Sunday. I hope that you'll be able to join me in the next future Sundays as we endure our social isolation through the coronavirus. I will be bringing more church services on video. Your patience. I'm used to speaking in front of many people In fact, I once spoke in front of 1,000 people and didn't even break out a sweat. But I have to confess that looking at that little camera just frightens the daylights out of me. So I'm used to having a church full of people. And so thank you very much for your patience as I relearn how to speak in front of a camera. But nonetheless, I hope in the future you'll join me. I hope you don't mind, but I would like to say a word of prayer for you right now. Abba, Father, I thank you so much for those who have watched this program. Thank you, Father, and I ask that you bless them. And Father, for those who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, may today be a time of encouragement to know, Father, that someday death itself will be defeated as our Lord Jesus Christ defeated it when he physically rose from the dead and walked out of that tomb. And Father, if there be anybody that is watching this video who has not yet accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, may they come to you in all sincerity. May they put their faith in the finished work of Christ on the cross, that he does forgive sins and that he can forgive, and that, Father, he can make them new again and bring them new life through himself. But Father, a blessing upon everyone who has watched this program today. And Father, we thank you for this beautiful promise of Easter. And it is in Christ's beautiful name we pray. Amen. I would like to thank the Graybills for bringing us the gift of music this morning, as well as Patti Fetrow. And at this time, we'll be hearing more from Patti as she shares some beautiful Easter hymns with us. Thank you again.
Good morning, church family, and happy Easter to you. The first song that I'm going to sing that you can join me in today, because again, we have lyric sheets for you, is Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Amen.
join me in singing the hymn, The Day of Resurrection. Come ye faithful, raise the strain. Today, Christ arose.